Billions of kilometers from Earth, beyond Neptune's orbit, lies perhaps the most forbidding part of our solar system. A vast realm so cold and dark, it sends a shiver of dread through even the most daring space explorers. There, the sun, so cheerful and warm here on Earth, appears merely as the brightest star in the night sky. And it's so cold that Pluto's atmosphere, the only one of 9 planets orbiting so far from the sun, remains frozen to the ground most of the time. A spacecraft, be it from Earth or alien origins, exploring the outer edges of our solar system might spend a lot of time wandering in seemingly empty space, barely seeing anything but stars and the occasional passing ice mountain. Indeed, for most of the last century, astronomers thought there was little to see out there. Just a small, icy planet, Pluto, and its odd moon, Charon. Perhaps it was better to move on and head towards a distant star. But wait! Maybe the outer solar system isn't so dull after all. Recently, astronomers have discovered that the frontier beyond Neptune, far from being empty, might actually be teeming with thousands of objects. This is being revealed to us by New Horizons, the same probe that took us to Pluto in July of 2015. In this video, we'll first get acquainted with what we know today about what lies beyond Neptune, and then we'll try to grasp the revolutionary scope of the new discoveries. What do you say, guys? Are you leaving or will you keep watching? When we think of the solar system, rocky planets like Earth, gas giants like Jupiter, natural satellites like the Moon, and asteroids orbiting between Mars and Jupiter come to mind. But the solar system doesn't end there. Beyond Neptune's orbit, the farthest planet from the Sun, extends a vast region populated by millions of icy objects, which are probably what's left of the material used 4.6 billion years ago to build our planetary system. Similar to the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter, the Kuiper belt could have become a planet if not for the cumbersome presence of Neptune, which prevented the fragments of rock and ice from joining to form a single large body. This region is called the Kuiper belt, but it's often also referred to as the Kuiper-Edgeworth belt, in honor of astronomers Gerard Kuiper and Kenneth Edgeworth, who were the first to hypothesize in the first half of the 20th century the existence of an accumulation of icy objects beyond Neptune's orbit. Indeed, it was from the discovery of Pluto in 1930 that the existence of other celestial bodies similar and positioned at the same distance or in the immediate vicinity began to be imagined. Then in 1943, Irish astronomer Kenneth Edgeworth advanced the idea that such a region could be occupied by a ring coplanar with the ecliptic formed by a large number of relatively small bodies. In 1951, Dutch astronomer Gerard Kuiper relaunched the idea with more conviction, although curiously his hypothesis was more about the fact that such a belt should no longer exist, disrupted by the gravitational force of Neptune and Pluto. Ironically, we might say that Gerard Kuiper was an advocate for the absence of the Kuiper belt, not its existence. For many years, this remained merely a scientific debate without evidence for one or against. In 1987, astronomer David Jewett and graduate student Jane Liu used the 2.2-meter telescope at the Canada-France-Hawaii Observatory to explore the outer solar system. After 5 years of research, on August 30, 1992, they announced the discovery of the first true resident of the Kuiper Belt, an object 43.9 AU away, which would later be found to have a diameter of about 150 kilometers and be named Albion, after the primordial man in William Blake's mythology. It seemed like the classic case of making a mountain out of a molehill, but from that mountain emerged thousands of other objects over the years, whose orbital calculations helped researchers identify the structure of the belt and estimate its size. Before moving on, be sure to leave a like and subscribe to our channel by clicking on the bell. This will encourage us to do better, and you'll never miss any of our weekly videos. Currently, we know that the belt extends from the Sun at a distance between 30 and 55 astronomical units, AU, where 1 AU is the average distance between the Earth and the Sun, about 150 million kilometers, and contains at least 100,000 objects with a diameter greater than 100 kilometers, although many more are thought to exist, too small or too faint to be detected. Unlike the asteroids in the main belt, which are predominantly made of rock or metal, most KBOs are bodies composed of frozen methane, ammonia, and water, and can display a wide range of colors from red to blue to white. The most famous of these objects is, of course, Pluto, the dwarf planet that until 2006 was considered the ninth planet of the solar system. But Pluto is not alone. In the last 20 years, thanks to technological advances in telescopes, many other objects of similar size comparable to Pluto, 2,450 kilometers in diameter, have been discovered. Objects like Eris, 2,326 kilometers, Makemake, 1,430 kilometers, Haumea, 1,595 kilometers, Quawar, 1,086 kilometers, and others, all with a diameter over 1,000 kilometers. These objects are called KBOs, short for Kuiper Belt objects, and they vary greatly in shape, size, color, composition, and orbit. Some are round, others elongated, still others irregular. Some are red, others gray, others white. Some are made of water ice, others of methane ice, still others of nitrogen ice. Some orbit close to the plane of the ecliptic, others have highly inclined or eccentric orbits. Some have one or more satellites, others are solitary. Many have their own satellites, while Haumea even has a ring of debris around it. As if that weren't enough, the Kuiper Belt also includes many binary systems. That is, two objects orbiting around a common center of mass. The most famous binary system in the Kuiper Belt is provided by the Pluto-Charon system. In recent years, we've begun to understand that the structure of the Kuiper Belt is much more complex than initially imagined. For example, the icy bodies we generally call KBOs are not uniformly distributed in space. Once astronomers began discovering them in the early 90s, one of the first surprises was that KBOs could be grouped based on the shapes and sizes of their orbits. This led to the understanding that there are distinct groupings or populations of these objects whose orbits provide clues about their history. The category an object belongs to has a lot to do with how it has interacted with Neptune's gravity over time. To give you an idea, outside of it exists a region called the scattering disk, which hosts objects that have been scattered by Neptune into highly elliptical and strong inclined orbits relative to the plane of the ecliptic. Many such objects have orbits inclined by tens of degrees, and some, think of Sedna, a large planetoid of at least 1,300 kilometers in diameter that reaches a distance of 487 AU from the Sun, venture hundreds of AUs from the Sun and well above the plane of the planets at the furthest point of their orbits, before returning to a perihelion, usually located near Neptune's orbit. The orbits of many objects in the scattered disk are still slowly evolving, with objects here being lost over time, compared to the classic Kuiper Belt, where orbits are more stable. The scattering disk gives the classic, rather flat Kuiper Belt a much wider and thicker extension. Some astronomers talk about the two as separate regions, although their boundaries overlap and are interconnected in various ways. Furthermore, the Kuiper Belt is thought to be a comet-forming zone, originating when Neptune's gravity catapults colliding KBO pieces towards our star. Unlike the Oort cloud, where most non-periodic comets are born, the Kuiper Belt is the cradle of periodic comets, i.e. those comets that take less than 200 years to complete an orbit around the Sun. The mechanism that builds cometary nuclei that are then pushed towards the Sun revolves all around the continuous fragmentation of the larger KBOs. The pieces produced by the collision of KBOs can be pushed by Neptune's gravity into orbits that send them towards the Sun, where Jupiter further gathers them into short cycles lasting 20 years or less. These are called short period Jupiter family comets. Given their frequent trips into the inner solar system, most tend to deplete their volatile ices quite quickly and eventually become dormant or dead comets with little or no detectable activity. Researchers have discovered that some near-Earth asteroids are actually exhausted comets, and most of them would have originated from the Kuiper Belt. Many comets crash into the Sun or planets. Those of close encounters with Jupiter tend to be torn apart or thrown out of the solar system. The other source of comets is, of course, the Oort cloud, from which most long-period comets with highly inclined orbits come. In short, KBOs are real worlds that tell us the story of the solar system and challenge us to explore and understand them better. The Kuiper Belt is the true frontier of the solar system and represents a great opportunity for science and adventure. A frontier, however, that looks very little like the solar system we know. American astronomer Fred Whipple said that if we want to continue to consider the solar system according to the familiar representation still used by many popular manuals, with the Sun at the center of a system of coplanar ellipses, it becomes really difficult to also include the remote, chaotic, and mysterious regions beyond Neptune. If we strive to see it instead as a complex physical system in continuous interaction, with the Sun at the center of an enormous sphere of influence that extends up to tens of thousands of astronomical units away, populated by a myriad of exotic objects and only a small minority of familiar objects located in its immediate vicinity, the known planets and satellites, then our view of the system changes profoundly. Until 30 years ago, in fact, the existence of the Kuiper Belt, as well as the more distant Oort cloud, were only working hypotheses, and until the early years of this century, the region beyond Pluto seemed inhabited only by a sparse representation of normal asteroids. Now, however, something new is happening. The probe from the New Horizons mission, the one that in 2015 showed us up close the incredible landscape of Pluto's surface, is currently exiting the Kuiper Belt, and it seems to have made a discovery that could change our assessment of its real dimensions. Currently, the New Horizons probe is about 60 AU from the Sun, that is 9 billion kilometers away, already beyond the hypothetical outer edge of the belt, in a region, therefore, where sometime there should be no trace of matter around it. According to current models, in fact, it is expected that the population of bodies in the Kuiper Belt, and with it the density of the resulting dust, would decrease at distances greater than 50 astronomical units, about 7.5 billion kilometers from the Sun. However, the new data seems to contradict this prediction. At the beginning of 2024, in fact, one of the probe's detectors recorded an unexpected increase in the amount of dust it was encountering. And since that material evidently can only come from continuous collisions between larger rocks, it appeared clear to many researchers that even beyond the threshold of 55 astronomical units, there must exist an extensive population of KBOs. If so, the boundaries of our solar system would need to be redrawn, and our models on its formation would need to be reconsidered. In short, the Kuiper Belt could extend many billions of kilometers beyond current expectations, up to 80 astronomical units, about 12 billion kilometers from the Sun. There might even be a second belt in addition to the already known one. You may be wondering, somewhat skeptically, why New Horizons has only spotted dust and not also large asteroids. Well, it must be understood that at that distance from the Sun, however crowded the belt may be, the KBOs are still separated by millions of kilometers from each other. It would therefore have been very unlikely for the probe to encounter an actual KBO. In these cases, the only possibility is to measure the presence or absence of dust. However, there are alternative explanations, albeit perhaps less likely to justify the high levels of dust recorded by New Horizons. The dust could also be pushed towards the outer regions of the belt. In short, in the sky, as on Earth, things are never quite what they seem. Everything is transformed, and suddenly change seems to be going so fast that we are left with no other option but to stand by and watch, hoping that our fearless spacecraft, now far away from us, will continue to send us the ever smaller tiles of that cosmic puzzle that does not want to stop amazing us.